get and how to get. So Dr. Madan is here. Dr. Madan is ICRISAC's head of the library, and he will share his experiences. Yeah.
Thank you, Madan.
Thank you so much.
Good morning. I'm Madan. I'm practicing librarianship for about 15 years. Actually, my topic here is about, Dr. Divakar says, it's about more about information, not much about technology. Before I embark on the topic or to start up, I would like to discuss a few points this morning. Some of the participants raised. I think personal contact is the key for knowledge sharing. There is a subtle difference between information and knowledge. What is information? What is knowledge? Is a very basic question that we have to first address, and then comes the technologies and other mediums that we are going to employ to transfer such knowledge. Earthquake kills people is an information. This information to a librarian is a news. This information to an ICT practitioner, again it is a news. But for a civil engineer, when he puts this information into his own context, then he develops another question. Is it earthquake's motive to kill people? Earthquake is a common phenomenon, but it is not the earthquake which kills people, it is the houses that we build kills people. So when you put this information into your own context, then it elevates to another level called knowledge. Then there is another level called wisdom. So there is a hierarchy in placing information. So when you put information into right context, then something else comes out. As he rightly said, certain things we can't really codify. For example, I need to learn how to swim. I don't know swimming. I just want to learn swimming. Can I read a book and go and jump into water? So I need a coach here. The coach transfers his knowledge, his tacit knowledge, which is in his mind only. No computers can help us. No mobile phones can help us. Tablet medias cannot help us. Can you hold a tablet PC or tablets, whatever gadgets that you have, and jump into water? It has all the knowledge, all the information. How to knot a tie was a big question once upon a time. Now that video comes in that demonstrates, it's okay for us. Before videos, by writing, by figuring it out, it was so difficult for us. Otherwise, if a person who helps me to knot a tie is easy way of doing things. So technology is no longer at the forefront. It is, knowledge is within human. You have to first understand that. Then we can speak about any technology that we are employing. Let it be hi-fi or rocket science, whatever it is. Nothing can help us. The individuals who has to come forward to share their ideas, which the other person should be in a mode to receive it, then the transfer occurs. Otherwise, all other mediums are just mediums for us. In that sense, I would like to. I'm a librarian. You know, I'm one of the most hard pressed creature in our the unit. Soon after the internet came into life, everybody started questioning about the existence of libraries. What is the point of having libraries anymore? I have internet. My mobile phone has access to Google. I can search anything and I can get information in a few seconds. So why should I go to library? So probably the user community hasn't understood the value of libraries first. And they haven't properly understood the value of internet also. So when you have misunderstandings both the sides, so you are making some conclusions which seems to be sometimes right, but sometimes it's not understood in a depth. That's what is my argument is going to be. Well, internet penetrated already. I'm booking my tickets, e-tickets, wherever I want to fly or try and go take the railroad. I don't go to railway stations. Before going to the station, I have my tickets printed. I can purchase shoes. I can talk to friends. I can share photos with my friends. I can be connected online almost every second. Whenever I'm having a powerful mobile phone, then I'm connected with almost 100 people or 200 people online, which is quite possible. If you, you know, you are all coming across airports and everybody is something, you know, scratching mobile phones and speaking to somebody or communicating it or something. This has been happening in the world for quite a few years. Okay. People are talking, people are assembling. Facebook has become the societal third place. For me, office is what the first place, a second place. House is the first place for me because where I go relax, I'm enjoying with my family. My next job is library. What is my third place in the society? Before the internet and other things, people used to go to parks to meet people. People used to go to libraries to build communities. Used to go to tea shops for morning reading newspaper and chatting with other friends in that village or in that community. Now we are in Facebook because there are some urgencies. Facebook has emerged as a societal third place for certain community. They are by and large digital natives. They born with the technology. At the young age, they started handling these kind of devices and they think that this is the only way of connecting to the people, so they are in that place, the societal third place. Facebook is the largest populated area. If you count the number of people living, I think it is one of the largest countries, invisible, virtual world. That's what people are saying. So I have a basic question here. Is there any other technology in the past has made such impacts on human lives? All walks of life. Yes, internet has made it now. We are in the transformation phase. We know the power of technology now. We have a telepresence center which can connect people from wherever they are. Yes, of course. Was there any technology in the past which made a similar impact? Can anyone of you? The history helps. What I wanted to tell you is, if you go back to the history, how those generations could overcome these kind of dilemmas, if we can learn, I think probably it will help us to overcome the hurdles or the dilemmas that we are going across now. That is predominantly my interest. Is there any technology or telephone, anything else? TV. Excellent. Then radio. Then bulb, electricity. You are talking about electricity
and newspaper, something.
Yeah. Well, yes, these are all impact-made technologies. Of course, the librarians here probably may know the word. See, there are a lot of ratings. In the past 1,000 years, in the previous centuries, 10 centuries or millennium, there are some important names, influential individuals. There are a lot of ratings. Time magazine is rating. There are gods rated. Jesus Christ and Muhammad, and these are all the most influential names in the past 2,000 years. We can't replace that.
yes, they have made clear impact, mobilization of community. You know, their doctrines have been practiced all over the world. But one name called Johannes Gutenberg, he invented the movable printing press. This is a very simple technology. The technologies are taken very granted by the modern community. Okay. The bond, when the print was already well entrenched in our system. Books are not a new object for us. Books are there. Books are part of our life. Printing, newspaper, everything was part of our life. So we could not really realize the value of those print on paper medium. But if I'm right, in the 15th century, there were no books. There were no way of communicating things properly. Chinese invented the newspaper, paper technology. They invented even the printing also by that time, before 13th century. But they were not able to find a technology by which they can produce mass literature. Then the name Johannes Gutenberg came. He invented one technology called movable printing press. What Chinese invented as blocks, you have to really carve for every paper. So the Gutenberg invented a metallic letter-based metallic structure by which you can move letters and reorganize your, the printing technologies. It's very simple. We knew about it. Till a few years ago, this was the best technology since its invention, around 1500s, for 500 to 600 years old, 600 years, one technology dominated. You may think it is my perception. No, it is not. For example, I said technology is taken for granted. So if you go and ask your grandmother, 100 years old, she's also a human being, you know, she has every right to live in this world. If you go and ask her which technology helped you a lot, removed your ailments, what would be her answer? Mobile phone? Or the tablet PCs? Or something? The real answer was, one of my friends asked her grandmother, who is 100 years old, which technology helped you really? She said, Matchbox. Matchbox is still considered to be one of the highly innovative item. Preservation of fire was such a difficult job in the past. You can't really preserve fire. One in a village, one home should, stove should always on the burning mode. Otherwise the other houses in the evening cannot lit fire for their food. By the time the idea of matchsticks and matchbox came, that relieve the whole ailment of a big community. But matchbox, we take it very granted. It's very easy. So if you can look at the past, the revolutionary technologies, we can't leave out simple things. So the internet and what we speak about, the Facebook, all that are not just come from void. It's all a part of an incremental process in terms of human evolution, communication and system. We have to look at in that angle only. The immediate effect of the printing press was to multiply the output and cut the costs of books. This morning we were discussing about, we have lots of technologies, but who can afford? Who can afford? That is the problem. It thus made information available to a much larger segment of the population, who are of course eager for information of any variety. So our community is eager or not is another question comes in here. Libraries could now store greater quantities of information at much lower cost. Now, printing also facilitated the dissemination and preservation of knowledge in standardized form. This was most important in the advance of science, technology and scholarship. The printing press certainly initiated an information revolution.
on par with the internet today. Printing could and did spread new ideas quickly with greater impact. I don't say it's not my perspective. It is I took this matter from History Guide. You know, the new iPads or something. The iPads optimization team decided how to really present books readable there. They chose page turner. In any iPad, the page turner technology, everybody has adopted. Even Kindle that I'm using is page turner facility. The page turner, the Kodak form of book, was more than 2,000 year old innovation. That is the best form of presenting a book. Before that, we had scrolling books. I used to tell almost in all my stories, I think we have to really know the value of history here. Scrolling books. If you have 300 pages scrolling, not possible. That time came in the Kodak format. Even now, the concept of page turning exists. No technology is vanishing. No idea, you know, if it is a powerful innovation, it will survive centuries and millenniums together. It will not see absolutions very quickly. Well, then, the point of existence of libraries that I raised at the beginning of my talk comes in. Okay, now internet has come in. At least some part of the world has got good bandwidth connectivity, and they are keep on improving, no doubt about it. Is it immediately going to replace all other system existed in the past? Is it really possible? Okay, then the question is, when the printing technology came in, there were scribes. Before printing, the only methodology available was writing by hand. Bibles were written in copies. They were writing Bible copies by handwritten and disseminated. It was a costly item. One king's 5 copies of some important handwritten material got fired and then gone. It's a work of 10-15 years of scribes gone. There was no preservation technology. All the scribes went jobless after printing press. No, it was not. Even after printing press, 200 years they survived. Their roles changed. They started helping the printing press in what they form, how to form the print and everything. And to my surprise, the Benedictine Abbey of Christ in the desert, still even now there are some monks are working as scribes, even after printing press. No technology can easily replace the existed technologies very quickly. It will take its own time to really come in. Unless you convince me that internet has everything for everybody, the previous systems requirement is still existing. We have to take that in conscious. So my argument is going to be on the information availability on the web or on the other systems. Now let me come to our area, science communication. As I said, I think all technologies and everything is part of a research, byproduct or output of a research. But that scientists first communicate themselves. Scientific ideas are not coming from void. Even Newton says that I am standing on the shoulders of giants. One has to stand on the shoulders of others, then only they can see further. I am reading one paper and put my ideas on top of it, so I am able to see better than that other paper. That is the way scientific knowledge is progressing. The print technology was used quickly by scientists. They invented an item called exclusive scientific journals for scientists to communicate. The first journal was introduced in France, Journal des Savants. After that, soon after, within a month, another journal was invented called Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society. They were the first of the journals in the world. Started in the year 1665. Here another problem. Why the journals were started? Scientists were ready with results, but they were so scared to release the results. Others will claim that it is my idea. So scientists were so preservative and conservative that time. Scientists have always been conservative, even now. And that time it was so intense. So if they don't, for example, snake bites. There are a lot of good medicines in the tribal areas. They didn't reveal it.
Most of the important medicinal technologies of anthropological value have not been available in public domain. So to facilitate the system of communicating and sharing knowledge,
the journals were invented
to claim priority of ideas.
If I write a paper in a journal,
which means that I am the owner for that information, if somebody wants to use, they have to cite it
or they have to give me some money for the patents that I have made. So all that systems were built to facilitate sharing knowledge. Journals helps to claim priority of ideas for an individual.
At the same time, he's telling the other scientists who are interested or possible would-be users of his knowledge to use and build on.
All important research from that point,
1665, and till now, journals have been playing
a very, very important role for communication and sharing knowledge among scientists. Mendel's paper, probably all the genetists know the controversy.
Mendel's original ideas were unknown for 3 decades as a controversy. Why his idea was not taken up for 3 years? I would often quote the idea of penicillin. Penicillin was an important invention that time. But it was invented by a doctor. He found in the Second World War, bacteria killed more people than the enemy artilleries. And then he went and found that important mold called penicillin. For another 1 decade, nobody could invent that. Nobody could identify and perfect that technology. The scientific obscurity is always happening. Even if you have n number of technologies, it is all about humans. How do they take it? How do they really absorb, assimilate and produce further is in the hands of humans. So Mendel paper,
for 3 decades it was not, it was unknown to the world. Even now his concepts are used in genetics. People say 40 reprints of Mendel's landmark paper, which was published in a journal from Germany. The journal's name is the Proceedings of the Brown Society. 40 reprints of Mendel's landmark paper were distributed among his contemporary scientists in Europe. Practically all prominent biologists of the mid-19th century had access to Mendel's paper, but our inquiry as to whether any of them had consulted it produced no definite answers. The information was available to the scientists. Now we are coming, we are speaking about communicating to farmers. The scientist's main job is to read, you know, getting ideas from others. But even then, the doubt is nobody could properly consult it. Even Darwin, whether the controversy is whether he has got his paper or not, something I don't know. Even the historians do not know. And the possible suggestion is Darwin says, Darwin probably might not have been impressed with Mendel's idea, but after 3 decades it became, started huge revolutions. Even if you pass information to somebody, their existing knowledge should allow us to really assimilate that information to produce knowledge here. Okay? Just passing information can't help, will not help.
For even for scientists, the learned society is struggling for that obscurity. So obviously, our farmers will struggle. We have to find ways for that also.
Well, initially, scientific societies managed journals. There were very few societies, very few scientists. I would say till the Cold War in 1950s around, there were not much great strides in science. The Cold War created the federal science. Government started investing on science, technology, and whatever we are speaking about. Then, if you ask a question, the scientists, all parts of the world, have equal access to the knowledge produced across elsewhere. The journals created a divide. Now, the internet creates a divide. our Indian scientists were not able to access to the journals that were produced in the West. There was no medium of transportation. The ship has to come. If the journal was published today, it will reach India after 1.5 years. Indian Institute was subscribing to 800 journals and the Purdue University was subscribing to 1700 journals. The access to journals created a divide.
So when you ask
a question here, has internet really made the level playing field? If you ask that question, I would say no. Yes, came in the internet first and the web and related technologies next.
Added to it,
there are a lot of gadgets. If you go to go to Bangkok kind of places in the local malls, I think you'll get an aversion seeing all these kind of devices. It's all cheap. The same brand is available for 2,000 rupees and 20,000 rupees. They say this is original, this is duplicate. Come on. And it's a creating a kind of aversion. We have everything. Yes, we have internet, we have mobile phone. Have we become knowledgeable? We know everything in this world? No. It is just, if you know how to search information, doesn't make people knowledgeable. It's about reading. It's about understanding. It is about putting what we are reading into context and then develop new knowledge. That is a very difficult job. That is what the libraries are still exclusive place for knowledge searchers. You come here to produce, put in context. We are keeping the place silent. We have at one place everything is available. In one book, all views are packed. In internet for that, otherwise you have to make at least 10 searches to compile information. Otherwise, instead of that, if you can find a good book, in that book, all views are packed together. That is with you. You can silently read. I'm not praising the unit, physical unit or something. I'm just imagining why the library was created. Libraries are still an exclusive place for the persons who wants to become knowledgeable. Well, what happened to journals? They were telling that paper cost was the problem, transportation cost was there. In any justification, they should have reduced the journal cost because internet and copies are not erosions. If they produce one copy, by downloading one copy from my machine, they are not going to lose anything. But in print, we need another copy. No, the journal costs went very, very high. Very, very high, which even my library, which you may feel that I am working for a rich organization, is not able to afford to very important journals that our scientists need. There are about 24,000 scientific periodicals published in the globe. They are publishing 2.5 million articles. Having all the articles in our desktop makes nothing for us. It's just not the access makes the problem, but access itself is the problem. If you look at agriculture, CAB abstracts, that indexes about 9,000 agricultural articles picked up from 9,000 journals. My library can't afford to subscribe to 9,000 journals here. I will not be able to find users for those 9,000 journals also.
So the real explosion.
And another problem is coming. If science, wherever, if the scientists want to produce a paper and he has to publish it in journals, published from either Western Europe or Northern America, otherwise their status will go low. In India, there is a common question that have you published your paper in Indian journal or international journal? These are all very, very peculiar items for, I would say, developing countries. Particularly in India, it is a sick. Journal is a journal. What is national or what is international about it? Science itself is an international phenomenon. Penicillin was invented in UK, and it is saving lives of India. So science is an international phenomenon. So there can be no national journals or something, systems can work. In this, the internet has created another big divide for us. The divide I am feeling here We have centers in Africa. We have center in Patancheru. The facilities in Patancheru is very, very high. I'm not able to make the similar facilities for my scientists in African centers. There is no level playing field for us. They are crying. They are lamenting. They have access to good laboratories in Patancheru. They have access to good library and information resources quickly available. Our internet speed is dead low. To download your article, it takes ages for us. So it has created a divide. So internet is not an universal phenomenon as yet. It has to be improved. It is growing. It is still incomplete. The enclosures do continue. Publishers are still selling the information through internet. Okay? Publishers quickly adopted internet and made their marketplace there. If you want to download an article, you have to pay for it, which we were doing even in the print area. So internet is not doing magics. Internet has reduced the transportation cost. Let us look at things objectively. I said it creates a divide. Doing science, doing work in India, doing work in USA, Europe, or other developed countries is entirely different. Why I am saying that Indian journal, international journal, problem. When I made a study on chickpea research published in the past 10 years or so, I found Pakistan Journal of Botany in which a lot of chickpea research papers have been published. I am sure in that journal, only Pakistanis would have published all the articles. There wouldn't be any other community interaction in that, because that is a national journal. It's a perception. All those national journals are getting lower average citation per item, because the Pakistan Journal of Botany is not read by another botanist in USA or UK or wherever else, because these journals are not subscribed by them. These journals are not available online. They don't have the marketing skills that the other competitive publishers like Elsevier, Springer, or Wiley is doing. It's not possible. So the articles or the ideas that are communicated through a particular journal, which is so-called national journals, the outreach is very slow. It is not reaching to the intended audiences. But at the same time, if you look at the Euphytica, theoretical applied genetics, and other crop science, otherwise their average sites per item is, even for theoretical applied genetics, it is 34.17. There is no other go. Our breeders, genetists, our modern biologists, new biologists should identify correct journals to publish their papers if you want to reach to the community. So there is again a confused divide. It is not just that if you put your paper online, it goes. The scientific system is embedded with a lot of clutches. It should be a good journal, it should be impact factor, all that is a greater confusion for them. They haven't properly understood the system. In this background, there was a subversive proposal proposed by a cognitive professor called Stephen Harnack. He said, scholarly skywriting. Whomsoever write, let us write on the sky so that everyone can see. And whomsoever wants to use, and they will use and build on. The proposal is to free the literature. The basic question was, scientific research is funded by federal agencies. Government is funding. Federal agencies. Nowadays, there are private agencies come, but with the mandate that you have to make the literature openly available to other community. The facilities for doing research like ICRISAT or ICAR laboratories or IARI is again built by government. The scientists are paid by government agencies. The research results that they produce is under the financial firewall of European or Western European or Northern American publishers. It's unreasonable for everybody. Research is communicated for the fellow researchers to use and build on. That is where the incentive for the researchers exists. Even then, they embrace a system which is putting financial firewall, a small directorate of ICAR and ICRISAT spending can't be comparable. But they are doing same research. They want to improve crops and we want to improve crops. They can't have access to many journals that my library has access to. It's a kind of divide. So what Harnack proposed, these scientific literature should come to the public domain. The first clever idea of using internet and related technologies came in for me. It is not that just enjoying everything, where the literature should be available freely without any barrier for whomsoever want to use that information was our main motive. He got that inspiration from physicists. You know, scientific
community differs in science communication. They are working on the community norms. Certainly, physicists are not communicating the way agricultural scientists are communicating or development practitioners are communicating. What physics researchers do, as soon as the research is over, they make the first draft, they put the first draft in this repository open to all. Almost all great physicists in the world use this repository. I know the archive has a mirror server in Chennai where the Institute of Mathematical Sciences is running. They don't worry about impact factor, they don't worry about who somebody will steal my idea, they don't worry about plagiarism, all that and all. So in that repository, other physicists started commenting on his research. That is what the social media tools that they are now proposing, that collective intelligence. Then they reorient their research according to the suggestion or they stand by it. Once that discussion is over, then only they send it for journal publication as a registration. It's a purely open community. I would like to ask you a question. A point I would like to mention. God particle exists or not was a problem for physicists some 10-15 years ago. All the governments internationally, they started funding and they could mobilize $4 billion to invent whether to identify, to know whether God particle exists or not. They finally found it was a massive structure. Yes, God particle exists. What is the use for us? Is it going to give me food tomorrow? Are our farmers are going to be relieved from all their problems and ailments? Is it going to improve the health of the developing country poor people or something? But that attracts funding very easily. Why? Performance, openness. You know, that internet that we are speaking, the Facebook that we are discussing, all that is a byproduct of the journey towards knowing whether God particle exists or not. It was a byproduct. The physicists wanted to communicate each other who spread across the globe. They wanted to properly communicate. They invented that internet, web and related technologies. CERN invented in the course of this investigation. There are a lot of byproducts coming. With that byproducts only we are playing. Whether we can take it to farmers, whether we can make scientist-scientist communication easy, all other things. After 20 years of archive, very recently, 2-3 weeks ago, the BioArchive beta came in. A similar preprint repository for biologists is now available, but it's very less populated. So following Stephen Harnard's idea, I'm one of the volunteers for Open Access Movement here. So we have set up a repository here where all the 40 years of research is available online. See, I'm again underlining, the precondition to use this resource is access to internet. So this, even our African scientists are struggling to use. It is creating only web-wide visibility. So all our research outputs are available here. So our idea is all the institution should take ownership of, you know, populating their institutional repository, make what they produce available to all other freely. Not publishing journal kind of clutches should be removed. So you may ask a question, if somebody wants to know information about, should he go visit one by one websites here and there to collect information? That would be a tedious job. If all institutions can produce such repositories, then one harvester can harvest all those records and create a single interface for you. This is working on certain protocol called OAIPMH, called Open Access Initiative Protocol for Metadata Harvesting. So these repositories are not just another websites. They are built on a strong protocol which helps harvesters to harvest and build services like that. Here,
it is an exclusive search engine for information which are freely available, exclusive. Here if you put a keyword chickpea, it will give you chickpea research. So the internet is a funny object. I would like to give an example. When I was studying mapping the chickpea research, I started collecting literature, putting keywords. Suddenly one core medical journal, which I thought it is about cardio disease or some very, very, very unique medical journal, there was an article came. Then I got surprised. Which chickpea researcher would publish in that core medical journal? Then I was fumbled. And there is no word on the title, no word in the abstract. But that article comes in when I searched using the word chickpea. At the end of the, at the conclusion, he has written only one line. See, this process creates a small tumor which is chickpea sized, he has written. You know, all, you know, there are problems with the keyword searching or something. You know, you have to sift the relevant what you want. So this service is existing here. Well, the publishers are not leaving us. They started, we are going to start open access journal. They challenged the subscription methodology. Now the libraries need not to subscribe journals. We are taking money from authors. Each author has to pay $3,000 to us if they want their journals to be published. And more funny thing is, they started another type of journals called PLOS One, which I am going to talk about. They are purely open access publishers. So it creates another divide for us. I have to, there are scientists who are publishing 30 papers a year in this campus. 30 into 3 is about $90,000. I have to give for exclusively every scientist, we have to allocate fund for their publication. Is it feasible, possible? Is it reasonable? It's my research, my brainchild, I'm going to communicate through web. For that, there is a medium required for us. So internet is captured by this kind of business minds by and large. The scientists, individual users have to be careful and decide in what way I have to communicate. For that, the libraries are creating systems for them to make their research available all. Now, a new journal concept has come up called mega journals. The journals in the course of evolution split into a lot of parts. There were no journals for agriculture. There are journals for cytogenetics. There are journals for microbiological research. But these mega journals say we will publish 30,000, 40,000 articles a year, where physicists will communicate, chemists will communicate, cognitive scientists will communicate, my library scientists will communicate, sociologists will communicate. There is only one journal called mega journal. What they will do is they will just vet a small preliminary peer review and publish everything. The peer review is a filter, is failing in these open access journals. If you pay money, they will publish articles. For that, you can publish in your own website. What's the problem? Why are you going to journal and publish it? What is the point? So these kind of questions are not answered. See, the web is creating a kind of lot of problems to the actually productive, creative communication and innovation here. So the journal, apart from journals, actually, the web has created some very positive impact also. When it was in print, there was no chance of scientists to communicate the actual data that underpins their research. They were their script, textual format, and with some tables and figures were only acceptable formats because the print has the handicaps. You can't, print is costly. You can't associate all the data sets along with your article. Now there is a fairly a good chance for us to associate our data sets along with the article, and most of the journals are now requiring data sets to be associated with the journals, journal articles. There is an initiative called Data Triad. It's a repository for data, and there are lots of journal publishers have made a consortium and then they have created a repository. Again, I'm doubt here. I'm proposing my doubt here. They want to claim the ownership for the data that you produce. You see, funnily, the scientists will, at their hard work, produce research output data sets.
publisher's son and daughters will sell to your son and daughters in the future because you are transferring the copyright. Internet has changed, has not changed anything out of it. That's what we are proposing. One thing that we have to use the web cleverly. We have to objectively look at the features of web. What is important for us? What is our clientele's needs? What is our clientele's assimilation power? And if you can pack information in such a way that my clients can use and assimilate, these mediums and technologies can be of no use. To protect publishers claiming copyrights for the data sets, we have created a data repository which will be coming to you, will be discussed in detail in the coming sessions. We are asking our scientists to preserve, make their data sets in their own properties as an institutional property. The way we have handled open access repository, we want to handle the data sets also. Then finally, altmetrics. The print medium, journals, articles, surprisingly, the evaluation of science is by and large done by the articles that they publish. It's another funny thing. You may produce magnum opus research, but unless you communicate as a journal article and it is not cited, you are not a good researcher. That is the way the system has created a lot of flaws within. The peer review was a good system. I know how your scientists work. He may not be able to write a paper, but he has produced a variety which is adopted by a major population, but he will be unknown to the scientific community unless he publishes a paper in a good journal and that goes cited very well. This was the existing norm. Every time when you go for promotion or something, you are asked in Indian government, all other developing countries, I'm not sure about developed countries or something, but everywhere, the number of papers published dictates the promotion of an individual scientist. That is another rubbish idea. But even then, that is the way the system is working. Now we are trying to put an alt metrics, article level metrics, removing journals away. How many times your article has been downloaded from my repository? How many times your data sets have been downloaded and cited in other papers? How many times you have got user requests? How many times your article has been bookmarked in social bookmarking tools? How many times there were tweets come about your article through the Twitter? How many persons have given a thumbs up note for your Facebook alert about your article? Can we bring everything into one package, and can we create a kind of alternative metrics to evaluate scientists? Is in the very preliminary stage of discussion. Metrics to evaluate scientists is in the very preliminary stage of discussion. It is really emerging as an alternative to the journal-based impact, the way we evaluate scientists, all that. So as a librarian, what I would like to propose is, let us put our strength on technology, what it actually deserves. Let us not create any hype on technologies. Technologies cannot do any wonder in this world unless the value of information, the packaging, our clientele assimilation power, which requires continuous capacity building, continuous reorientation of our research, continuous simplification of technologies. Only all that comes, we can really speak about development. Otherwise, we can all experiment, we can discuss in these meetings or something. The constructive things will be far away from now. Thank you so much. The floor is open for questions. I'm ready for discussion. Please, sir.
So you are in opinion that each and every institute have their own web servers to preserve their own database?
Absolutely. I have no doubt. I'm not going to reconsider that point. It is, when producing knowledge is the responsibility of individual institutes,
they have to take the responsibility of disseminating it to also. They can easily form part of the global network with available technologies. We have to cleverly employ the web and really free from the barriers, financial, language. If your material is going to be used in China, we have to work on how to convert into Chinese, and then we have to make arrangements, and then you have to identify your target clients, and you have to make your knowledge free from any kind of barriers first.
But what we generally believe that we always prefer to either read or assess a journals which are well known, which have good image in the world. And if we store our database in our own server, that might be in the server for a pretty long period, and people will not access. So in such a condition, we must publish our data in a well-known journal.
So you have to publish. I have no problem. You publish your paper in Nature or Science, absolutely fine. Nature and Science has a brand name. I would like to tell you, all the articles published in Nature are not highly cited. More than 50% of the papers published in Nature and Science haven't been even cited only once, even by the author themselves. Only a few articles are getting more citation. That gives a cumulative value as a brand name for those journals. We can speak about that in a different forum. You publish it in a journal is not a problem for federal funding, research and everything. At the same time, you have to make one copy in your server for the persons who are not able to afford to access to Science, Nature or something will have access to your server. You can make that arrangement. Please. These are all emerging. These are all when everything goes on, when the adoption of Facebook, Twitters throughout the world, they are trying whether scientists can infer something out of those thumbs ups or likes, dislikes, all that and all. Is statistically they are trying to build something. No. Much more. No, it's not. You see, unless your article is peer reviewed, scientific community will not accept that. We have to preserve that peer review part. For that, the existing journals only do that peer review job fairly well. So what you let the peer review exist, no problem. You publish your paper in journals. At the same time, you spread it. You have to have an agreement with the publisher that I will circulate to my friends and communities in this fashion. You have to reorient your copyrights and other things, and you can take it up for your community, spreading it and getting ideas from others. It's quite possible. That's a better idea at present, because we are already well entrenched with the publishing system. So coming out, giving up and coming out will make some harmful effects. Can use any technology. True. Please. Yes, I would like to recommend a couple of softwares for these repositories. One, the famous one is ePrints, which we have used here. It's open source. The another one is DSpace. Which is both of them are in terms of technical quality, both of them are same. And for my view, ePrints slightly has better advantages than DSpace. DSpace and ePrints are the softwares. Greenstone is a very old, Greenstone is coming up with all the features, but ePrints and dSpace are far superior than Greenstone. Greenstone is one of the oldest ideas. Just give up. You adopt ePrints or dSpace. That would be giving you a far better experience. Please.
Yeah, I have one question here.
Please.
See, lot of these referred journals which are published by IEEE, ACM, Springer, which are taking money from subscriber, that is one economic model.
Mm.
Another model is where journals, they take money from authors.
Author pay model.
Right, and publish it. Mm. There are lot, of late I have seen lot of controversies about open access journals.
Right.
And some of them are, you know, they are malicious.
Yes,
I will
true.
Quote, I will quote my own personal case where few journals in India,
true,
they word by word copied our papers.
Yes.
And published in India journals.
Yes.
And then we have to...
Scientific community should stand up and condemn those journals.
Yeah, but...
Say it is not about the open access journals,
yeah,
which makes the... they are predatory.
Yeah,
even in the print medium, there were predatory journals. So that is not new for the open access system alone. It is the problem with the science communication system itself.
Right.
The scientists should stand up and condemn those publishers to stop that. Hyderabad is a center for predatory journals called Omics Group. There is a person. If you get any mails from Omics, please ignore or rubbish it. It is the job of scientific community to correct the system.
So some awareness should be created.
Yes, we have created maximum awareness within the campus,
right,
and the other librarians in the other campus should really create.
Right.
Yeah.
I have another question here because you know you might be able to reply. See, lot of many times when we publish in IEEE ACM, whomever wants to read it has to download and pay for that. Now many researchers, what they do to improve their impact or citations, what they do, they purchase it from ACM or IEEE, then they upload on their own site. Now how that mechanism is working actually, because in that case you are supposed to go to ACM and download from ACM or IEEE and read it. In this case you go to their personal website and you get the same paper. So I think there is some arrangements between
that is, there are, it's all the problems at the excitement of seeing an acceptance of a paper. The moment scientists see their paper is accepted by so-and-so journal, they are just surrendering everything when you're signing that copyright transfer form. I'm not sure any of the scientists would read properly and retain their rights. That is where all the problems start. That excitement, immediately they sign, my paper is published in that journal, creates lots of problems. It's not going to help web or the librarians to really make your research available to the all. See, the open access movement was gaining momentum. Publishers allowed authors to archive the final refereed draft in any repositories in their personal websites. IEEE that time allowing us allowing the authors to open their articles, published version itself, in their own personal websites. These kind of permissions given by publishers, it differs from publisher to publisher. IEEE again changed now. IEEE now says the author's final refereed draft. You know, the article in double column with their logo, that they claim it's their model. So you have your own output in LaTeX or Word with all tables and figures, you can write on top of the paper that this has been published. This is the final refereed draft. After refereeing, that draft you can put it in institutional repository or personal websites. It's legally permissible. It's purely legitimate.
Which version cannot be published?
The publisher though? Version with logo and double column,
even,
that
even
legally you should not.
Even though it is word by word same, still you can do it?
Yeah, post-print you can do that. The same article, post-print, exact replica of the published version. Publishers initially claimed for the typeset the copyright, the typesetting, double column, logo and all that, arrangements and all. Now they are, authors are surrendering almost all selling rights to the publishers. There is a problem. There are a lot of awareness to be created in that area.
advantages of e-prints over D-Sync?
E-prints, I feel it's slightly Indianized for us. E-prints have proper templates for various types of documents that are normally produced in research organization and other places. DSpace is giving a kind of another flexibility that you can create document types. That is also a freedom. But ePrints is coming up with predetermined things. It is very easy. There are no clutches. It's so friendly. All for all formats. And it gives you, for example, your thesis. You want to make it open. But the researcher says that for 1 year, I don't want to make it open. After that, it can go open. So there is an embargo period here. These items, ePrints handle well. Thank you, sir.